Thank you, Madam President. Kind of unusual to be here on a Saturday morning here in Washington, D.C., but recognizing that we've been in the midst of a partial government shutdown for now 29 days, it seems to me that this is an absolutely appropriate place where we should be. We should be here working. We should be here trying to figure out how we get back to the business of governing. And I think it's fair to say that there has been a great deal of frustration. I think the four senators that are assembled in this chamber today are part of a group that has shared that frustration on a daily, if not hourly, basis. I think there have been very good faith efforts to try to advance discussions on a bipartisan basis, a bicameral basis, trying to allow for a process that would allow us to consider the work, the legitimate request of a president who has clear priorities when it comes to border security and what we need to do and how we might need to do it. But it's very difficult to do it when we're not fully governing, when you have a partial government shutdown, when you have men and women who we are asking to do the work within their agencies, but then they're not being paid. They're being told that they will be paid when this is all over, but the uncertainty of when that all over is very heavy on them, and their families. And so today, I wanted to share with colleagues the view from one community in Alaska. Alaska is a state that relies heavily on our Coast Guard. We have just about 3,000 active Coast Guard in the state, 2,972 exactly, and 285 civilians. We are proud to host the largest Coast Guard air station in the country on Kodiak. So Kodiak is, I thought it was the largest island in the country. It's not Hawaii beats us, the Big Island beats us. But Kodiak is a large island off of the south central part of the state of Alaska. There's about 6,000 people in Kodiak, 6,013, based on the last census. And within that Coast Guard community of Kodiak, you have 1,141 active duty, 102 civilian employees, and one Coast Guard reservist. So this is a community. When they say that we're a Coast Guard town, Kodiak is truly, truly a Coast Guard town. It's about one-third of the economy that is based off of the Coast Guard there. This is an island that, I don't know, I probably should have checked air prices before I came to the floor here, but it seems to me the last time I flew down there, going out of Anchorage to Kodiak, is you're probably spending $400 to $500 for an airplane ticket. So you are geographically removed. You are removed certainly from a financial perspective in terms of your ability to move back and forth. Jobs are challenging in a community like this. December, January is usually the highest months of unemployment, but in December of just so last month, we were at 8.8% in Kodiak. You compare that to last January of 2018, it was 8.4%. So a lot of unemployment there. There's not a lot of jobs and job opportunity in a community like this. So you've got your Coast Guard, and the other economic base for the community really is our fisheries and our local and our small businesses. So within the fisheries, you've got your federal agencies that are there to provide for the opportunities. Right now we're going into the A season for pollock, I believe, coming up in just a few days. But This requires your agencies to be up and functioning. So it's NOAA, it's NMFS, it is Fish and Wildlife. You need to have these folks in their offices, answering the phone, responding to texts. We also, on Kodiak Island, have significant refuge land, parks land, and again, fish and wildlife managers on the refuge there. So you've got an island community cut off from the rest of the state, 4,400 miles probably from where we're sitting here today. And the reliance on the federal interests is probably pretty disproportionate relative to other communities. Much of the population, the indigenous population there, relies on the Kodiak Area Native Association health care. So the challenges that the Indian Health Services is having because the Department of Interior is shut down. So the impact in so many different ways on this community of 6,000 people is extraordinarily substantial. So I made contact with the spouses of the Coast Guard men and women there and asked if I could do a Skype, do a FaceTime with them while they were having coffee, because I wanted to understand for myself, what does it mean when you are the Coast Guard spouse and your husband or your wife is out either flying as a C-130 pilot down in the Aleutians, whether it is a helo pilot that is looking to do a medevac out of King Cove, whether it is the wife of one of the spouses who is out on the Alex Haley, whether it is the spouse that is at dry dock on the spar in Seward, the aviation instructor. These are all men and women that are going out and they're doing really important things for us in Alaska. This is a time of year when the fishing industry is going strong. It's crab season, but it's also not cruise weather for those who are out on the waters. And we rely on the extraordinary efforts of our Coast Guard men and women to provide for that search and rescue, if need be, the fisheries enforcement. So the role that the Coast Guard plays in not only supporting a local economy, but making sure that that second leg of our economy, the fisheries, are safe, regulated, and protected. Let me show you just the base there in Kodiak. It's nothing grandiose and beautiful and extraordinary. It is actually an extraordinarily beautiful location to be stationed there in Kodiak. But this is the community. This is where they live and work and raise their families. There are others that are sitting up on the hillside in housing, but it's a pretty tight-knit community. So to be able to visit with this group of spouses yesterday was really quite compelling. And so I wanted to just take a few minutes and share some of the comments from these primarily women and men about what's happening right now. One individual, Sarah, mentioned that her husband is out on the spar, which is a cutter. Well, they're in dry dock in Seward, another Coast Guard facility. But because they're not being paid, they're sitting in a community where they really have no resources to do anything. They have to stay on the ship. It's not like they can go off and go out and about. You're really kind of stuck there. Now, she happens to work for the Chamber of Commerce in Kodiak, and so was able to share some of the stories about the impact on the local businesses. And she was saying that you go on Facebook and there will be postings of empty restaurants, empty establishments saying, please come. We're looking for customers. There's a discount for coming in and having a cup of coffee. King's Diner, business is down 50%. They're offering a 10% discount to those without paychecks. We got a call from a gentleman who has a welding business there in Kodiak, and he says that he's out $300,000 in payments from Coast Guard projects that have already been completed. He says these contracts equal 10 to 15% of his gross annual income. So what is he doing? He's not a federal employee, but it's impacting his business in a significant way, and he's saying, I'm going to have to go out and get loans. So the impact on the community writ large is clearly significant. Some of the other comments that we heard was the effort to provide for food. So the effort to provide for local food distribution through a food pantry, and the effort to collect donations from around the state to be able to send down to Kodiak. These are things where you think, oh, look, the generosity of Alaskans to come together. But in talking to these spouses, they reminded me, we are the guardians of our homeland here. We are proud people. We are proud families. And to think that in order to be able to serve and to keep the family fed, I've got to go to a food pantry. This is really, really very, very hard. Kodiak, as you saw from the map there, isolated. Isolation delivers a lot of different things, and one thing that it clearly delivers is it's expensive to live there. It's expensive to live there. We were told that right now the price of gas is about $4 a gallon. There was a report that came out of NBC this week that mentioned that one individual said his weekly budget for food was three times more than his friend who happens to live in Ohio. So it is keeping your house warm, filling up your vehicle, buying groceries at the store. Childcare is something that we talked about extensively because the hours at the childcare center have been cut back. There is no alternative, really, out in the community for childcare for these Coast Guard men and women. There were not even two facilities where they were taking children under the age of 6 months. So infants that we're seeing on base, and apparently there's been a good slug of new babies that are born. We're growing some new Coast Guard recruits here. But when you don't have the ability to provide for childcare and you need to be working, where do you go? What do you do? The price of childcare, talking to one of the spouses, there's $1,600 a month. So think about that. You've got a child, $1,600 a month for one child. You're paying $4 a gallon for gas. You are four to 5,000 miles away from any family support. So it's not like you can just say to grandma or to your aunt, hey, can you come and help me with the kids? You don't have that kind of support like we do in other areas. So when we talk about the impacts of a shutdown, a partial shutdown, and not getting pay, at least for this period, for an indefinite period, it's more than just the financial impact. We talked a lot about that. But even more than the financial impact was the stress that comes to the families because of the financial impact. The reality you face as a Coast Guard family is you move a lot, so you have that stress. You're away from your family support system, like I mentioned. You have a lot of families with new kids. Now you don't know whether or not when you're going to see that pay. You're in a place where your costs are really high. You don't have many options for short-term or short-time work. I said, well, what are you doing? Are any of you getting additional work to help bridge this gap? And they all just kind of laughed. It wasn't a happy laugh. It was a cynical laugh. Like, where do you expect us to go to work when the establishments that we might go to, whether it's a restaurant or some small business, is posting things on Facebook saying, we need customers. You think they're going to hire people? That's not happening in a community like this. And further, they don't know how long they may be there. If it requires some level of training and you can't commit and you say, well, if the government gets back to business, maybe, I don't need to be here. Well, you're not going to be investing. You're not going to be investing that in that individual. So you have that stressor. The stress that I think our families see, and I have such respect for the men and women who are staying at home well, are active, are serving, whether they're helping pluck fishermen out of the sea in the north or whether they're interdicting drugs in the southern waters. Spouses have learned how to hold things together and be the tough, just figure it out. There's not a lot of complaining that's going on. But when you have a mom tell me, as she did yesterday, that the spending money that the kids got for Christmas, they said, we're not going to spend it, Mom, because we think we might need it for food. When the 13-year-old girl says, I'm not going to cash the birthday check that I got for Grandma because we might need it. And I was reminded by several of these spouses that this is an adult problem. This is not a kid's problem. Our children should not have to be worrying about this. But they can't help but pick it up. They know what is going on, and they are worried. To have the mom tell me, one of the moms say, we're just doing everything to pull it together. So I'm having to say things like, I'm sorry, we're not going to be ordering the yearbook. This is not paying for fancy sports programs even. It's, I don't know that we're going to be able to order the yearbook. And it's canceling tutors. It's making a difference in all of that. I think again about the weight that our spouses are bearing and how they are handling it. One woman said, hey, we're lucky. My husband is an avid hunter and a fisherman. We've got a freezer full of meat. We've got moose and salmon, but not everybody is so lucky here. One woman said, I have made a complete inventory of everything that I have in the pantry just so I know and I can be planning ahead. But this is hard on everyone. The impact to enlistment is something we need to be thinking about, and that was raised repeatedly. One woman said, my husband and I both joined the Coast Guard because we liked the stability that this offered us. And maybe not stability insofar as moving around from location to location, but stability in the fact that you're a federal employee. You're going to have that support from your government. And she says, you know, now I don't think of this as a very stable opportunity. Another thing I learned yesterday is that it was just apparently just a week or so ago, maybe it was a couple weeks ago, that the Coast Guard, the boot camp where the new recruits come in, it's a six-week program. Maybe I shouldn't say how long the program is because I don't entirely know, but they just completed it. Well, they completed it during the shutdown. Where did those young Coasties go, the ones that have the new shaved good-looking top? They went back home. They sent them back home because they don't have any place for them to go. What do you think that does to recruitment? What do you think that does to recruitment? Another thing that came up that was fascinating to me that we don't think about in this land of unintended consequences when you have a partial government shutdown that goes on for 29 days. These Coast Guard men and women, they're federal employees, when they do any travel, official travel, goes on your official card. Well, that card is issued in your name. So if you are the Coast Guardman that needs to go out and inspect a boat in Dutch Harbor, and you're based out of Anchorage, a flight to Dutch Harbor, round trip, I don't know, last I checked, it's close to $1,000. So that goes on the card, and the way the process works is the card is, you're reimbursed on your government card. But during this shutdown, none of these expenses are being reimbursed. And that card is tied to your name, tied to your credit rating. And that was where the conversation really got lively, when the spouses were talking about, do you know what happens to us when the credit rating goes south? Do you know what that means in terms of our ability to have a security clearance? Do you know what that means in terms of our ability for transfer? And it would be one thing if you could say, oh, well, I'll just pay for it out of my savings. And that was what another spouse said to me. She said, you know, I really take offense because I feel that there are a lot of people out there that have placed judgment on us because they said, you should have saved for something like this. And the response is, I'm in the Coast Guard. I move around. Many of these families have invested in a home and then they're transferred. They keep that home. They try to make some money off of it. Many of them rent to another Coastie family. Now that family is not getting paid either. The stress compiled upon the stress is just awful. We were reminded that, look, this isn't a natural disaster, this is a man-made disaster. Another woman said, military are proud, we should be honored and respected. But one that said it really well, summed it up from the Coast Guard's view, in my opinion. She says, you know, we're not going to sink. We're not going to sink. We will still float. But that doesn't mean that we're not upset and we're not angry. And they said this, they shared this all with a great deal of respect and but truly, truly begging for us to resolve these issues. And they understand that there is this effort out there to pay the active and the military Coast Guard. But they're a Coast Guard family in this base, and you've got active Coast Guard working side by side with the civilians, those that are helping them keep those boats in tip-top shape, keeping the helos in the air, keeping the C-130s in the air. They're all working it together. And so how is it right that side by side, oftentimes sharing the same job, that one would get that pay and the others would not? So they've asked, don't forget the civilian side as well. I'm going to end my comments because I know that the senator from Virginia would like to speak as well. I've got a soft spot in my heart for Kodiak. I think it's because I'm a Coast Guard kid myself. But when I go to Kodiak, the gathering place in Kodiak is a great little brewery called Kodiak Brewery. And it's the gathering place for not only the politicians that come to town, but all the Coasties. The community comes together, and this is where birthdays take place. This is where you come and have a beer after work. This was a post from yesterday. It says, this is a sad, empty brewery. We're lonely and you're thirsty, and we want to support our community in a time of need. We're doing a shutdown sale, $1 off servings until sanity prevails. Hopefully we all get through this, but there's not a soul in the place. And it's just a reminder to me, again, the extraordinary ripple effect when you say, well, it's just the federal employees. First of all, I think that that's offensive because our federal employees do extraordinary service for our country. But it is all of us, and it is up to all of us to get this resolved. I have been so disappointed this week that we have not been able to advance a more positive solution to work on an immediate outcome to help with this. But my frustration is nothing compared to these families, these men and women who are serving, those who are staying at home, the worry and the angst and the stress that we see. We owe it to the people of Kodiak, we owe it to the people of this country to get this place working again. And with that, Madam President, I yield the floor.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi issued a statement following President Trump's announced compromise to end the government shutdown and provide additional border security. This said in part, the president's proposal is a compilation of several